Howdy, folks. Jess Chernad here on KR92 for what we're going to call Chernad's Singer Sit Down. First edition of that would have been with Lucas Matty back for the FFA alumni fundraiser. But now we're getting a chance to hear from Courtland Fun Day's headliner act, Cody Canada and the Departed. Here's a tune to get you in the mood in case you forgot or just don't know who he is.
Sirens wail in a flashing light. Nothing better to do on a Tuesday night but give me hell. Where are you headed? What are you out for? We don't see much of you around here anymore. I guess it's just as well. Once upon a time you had it all. Let everybody down. You're always 17 in your hometown. Running from your folks, running from the law. Running from love, running from your fears, running from it all. You keep on running, boy. Run yourself in the ground. You're always 17 in your hometown. The porch swing still looks the same. She probably won't even remember my name, just like she didn't back then. Is she married? Is she doing fine? Does she know about all the nights I laid awake crying just to know her hand? The door opens and I run away just like the same old clown. You're always 17 in your hometown. Running from your folks, running from the law. Running from love, running from your fear, running from it all. You keep on running, boy. You run yourself in the ground. You're always 17 in your hometown. Gonna miss me. No tears will fall. No one's gonna weep when I hit that road. My boots are broken. My brain is sore from keeping up with their little world. I got a heavy load. Gonna leave them all just like before. I'm big city bound. You're always 17 in your hometown. Running from your folks, running from the law. Running from love, running from your fear, running from it all. Keep on running, boy. You run yourself in the ground. You're always 17. Yeah, you're always 17. You're always 17 in your hometown.
And to start things off with something you folks might know or jog your memory, in case you weren't aware, Cody Canada used to be the lead singer for Cross Canadian Ragweed. There was a classic that really hits Belleville and Republic County on the head. Old Cross Canadian hit 17. Here with me now is Cody Canada of Cody Canada and the Departed, set to play July 28th in Courtland for free. Can't really beat that deal. Cody, how are you doing today?
I'm good. How are you, man?
Fantastic. Nice hot day. Good thing I'm staying cool here at the station. Now, if you'd like to go ahead and tell us just a little bit about your history. I guess I've been following you since I was about knee-high to a grasshopper, driving around with my brother in his car, listening to you guys, really the first artists I can ever really remember listening to. Now, whether or not I should have been listening to you guys when I was 4 or 5, certainly up for debate. Now, whether or not my nieces should be listening to you guys when they're 6 or 7, we'll just hope their parents aren't paying attention to this.
Yeah, it wasn't that bad. Now, come on.
Well, I mean, now I can look back and say, yeah, the music was great. Definitely gave me somebody good to listen to. But yeah, you guys have been at this for a while, 25 years now.
Yeah, Jeremy Plato and I, he's my bass player. He and I have known each other for about 30 years. We're both 42. After I hit 40, I quit counting. See, we're both 42. And we started playing together when we were young, and then we formed Ragweed in about 94. We were seniors in high school. And we did that for about 16 years, and the other two guys in the band didn't really want to continue going down the path we were doing, and we had some disagreements. You know, I wanted to stay a cult followed band, and somebody in the band wanted us to move on to country Nashville stuff, and I'm just anti-establishment, you know, and I've always been that way.
Well, thank goodness for that.
So we split. I started The Departed in 2010. And really, I quit playing all the old songs, and it hurt me. I was kind of bitter because, you know, I was upset that the band broke up. It's like, you know, like getting a divorce, but from three people, you know. And I quit playing the songs, and then one time I was out in California, this lady said, "It's not the band that we miss, it's your songs. Please sing the songs." So about 4 years ago, I started doing the songs again, and everything's been on the up and up since, you know. And went through several band members, and finally broke it down to 3 band members this last year and a half, and it's exactly what we needed to do. I thought the more people you had in the band, the better it would be, but that's not the case, not in this case. We just play as a 3-piece, you know, lead, rhythm, harmony, bass, drums.
Yeah, and as that reflects, I guess, in your guys' latest album name, you're already kind of jumping ahead of me there, but we'll get to that later. Looking back, though, clear to 1994, how much would you say things have changed since then?
You know, when it comes to what how I do it and how I've always approached music, it's really a selfish way. I mean, I've always played music for myself because I just like to do it. And once I found out that you could create... When I was younger, I didn't know that you could write your own songs. This is real stupid. But I didn't know that you could write your own songs and perform your own songs. I thought that you either did one or the other. You either wrote songs for other people or you had to be the guy singing it. I didn't know that you could. I grew up watching Nashville stuff, you know. But really, it's the same. I mean, I went through a record label thing for several years, several records, 5 records, I believe, or something like that. And, I've really just stayed the course. I mean, I've just done what has worked for me. And it might have changed a little bit when we first got to The Party together. I changed the music a little bit, but I got to missing it and realizing what, I don't know, just who I am, I guess. You know, I heard when you hit 40, you start realizing things. And I did, and I started doing all the old stuff again and just doing it the way I used to do it because that's how it worked. And if it worked back then, it's definitely going to work now.
Mm-hmm. I guess just talking about you on a personal level. Now, when you're looking around, obviously you've been in the game for a while. You've worked with a lot of great guys, and I know a lot of guys out there are starting to look up to you, not to make you feel old, but who would you say would be the most fun you've had working with when you used to be opening for guys or guys now opening for you?
You know, when when we first started this thing, I remember playing Six Flags in Dallas, opened up for Jack Ingram, who was, you know, a hero of mine. And about a year later, we were back at the same gig, and he was opening for us. And it was really strange. It was, I don't know, I felt bad about it. He didn't. He was very supportive. But I don't know, it was just weird. I thought, you know, here's this guy that I think is like one of the best things out there. And a year ago, I was in front of him. And now he's in front of us. I don't know, it's strange. But I got to say, probably the best, my favorite people to ever work with was Rob Keane, going on tour with him. I did two tours with him. And he is definitely the number one hero of mine. And, man, they were just a pleasure to work with. And you couldn't ask for better people. And they were just sweet, caring, and whatever you needed. You know, a lot of times you play with people and you don't know them and they don't really care. You know, I mean, that's just how it is. A lot of people don't care that you're there to open, you know, and never even mention your name on stage. But Robert was always good. You know, he remembered everybody's name in the band, no matter what lineup it was. Say everybody's name on the microphone and have the crowd cheer for us. It was very supportive, you know. That's what I love about our little pocket of Americana music, is everybody really takes care of each other.
Yeah, and everyone definitely knows everyone for sure. Speaking of knowing everyone, right now we're going to go ahead and play one of the Departed's definitely more popular songs, All Nighter. And speaking then of knowing everyone, this one was quite the collaboration, working with the entire Braun family, those guys being of Reckless Kelly and Mickey and the Motor Cars. You want to talk a little bit about that one before we get to it?
Yeah, I'd love to, actually. It started with... I've known those guys. We've known those guys for like 20 years. And so Jason Bowen and I went to a concert in Dallas, and those guys opened up for Robert Earl Keane, and we'd never heard them before. It just blew our doors off. But I got to know them real well, and we did a lot of tours with them. And Mickey had lost his bass player in a river accident up in Idaho. All those boys are from Idaho. And his bass player drowned, you know, and is a lifelong friend. And man, the day that he was laid to rest, everybody in our scene of music dressed like him. He used to wear a shirt and tie with a vest every night. And the day that he was buried, everybody was scattered all over the country playing music, but everybody was sharing pictures of how they were dressing up for, we called him Gus. Everybody was dressing up for Gus. And I don't know, it just really kind of started that whole thing of this singing about how people were celebrating his life from coast to coast. I mean, there was people in Idaho that were there at his funeral. There was people in California. I myself was in New York City on Washington Square, and that's where that line came from. And well, I wrote the thing for that reason, and Muzzy, the Braun dad,
mm-hmm.
You know, I told him that I really wanted I got two boys, and I said, I really want my kids to be tight and close to me like your guys are. And how'd you do it? And he said, man, just keep them close by your side, and they'll be your best friends. You know, don't be overprotective. You know, let them do their own thing, but also be there to guide them. And, you know, and just try to be patient with them. And, man, that's how it happened, you know. And we would go to the Bronze house a couple times a year, and I mean that's way up there in the mountains, and there's no cell service or anything, no lights, and we sat around their wood burning stove singing songs all night, and they were all nighters. And then one night I was there in January, and I was helping Muzzy put wood on that fire, and I'd already written this song and didn't change anything, but I noticed that the lid on it was called the All-Nighter. And I told Muzzy, I was like, you're not going to believe this, but the irony, I mean, I wrote this song for Gus and for you and the Braun boys, and I called it All-Nighter, and I had no idea that that was the name of the stove.
And, funny how life works.
I really wanted to, I mean, at that point it was too late. I already had the record in production, but I wanted to scrap the whole hippie love punk thing and call it All Nighter and just put the cover of that wood burning stove on there. But I don't know, that song just means a lot to me, you know. It Gus, I guess, was a friend of mine, but watching those Braun boys you know, just be devastated by the loss of a friend and a fellow musician and a fellow Idahoan and fisherman and just a friend, you know, and it really was upsetting to watch that. And that was really the first kind of, that was not the first, but it was really the closest person that we'd ever lost in our scene of music. So that's why that one means so much to me.
And here now, a fitting tribute to Gus McCoy.
Gypsies and winos, people that I know, all came together today. Church bells were swinging, old friends were singing, some that didn't have much to say. Down in the valley and up on the mountain, California to Washington Square. Dressed up and geared up, we're not gonna tear up. Today you were everywhere. Some days I hide, that's how it goes. Sometimes you just gotta run with the load. Keep them all tight and close by your side. Up, you losers, poets and movers, the night is upon us again. It's our turn to get some, don't make them feel lonesome, make them think you'll always win. Posers and pirates on the coattails of giants couldn't rhyme their way out of a bag. It was our job to brand it, so the plastic and bandits had their very own reason to brag. Some days I hide, that's how it goes. Sometimes you just gotta run with the load. Keep them all tight and close by your side. If the music is loose and it's free, smoke if you wanna, 'cause we're all gonna leave your shoes at the top of the stairs. It's an all-nighter, not a nail-biter. Tonight ain't nobody cares. Some days I hide, that's how it goes. Sometimes you just gotta run with the load. Keep them all tight and close by your side. 'Cause we are only here for a very short time.
And just Sernad back here for Sernad's Singer Sit Down. With me is Cody Canada of The Departed. Now let's talk about your latest project, which is literally only weeks old. Now, I've read how it harkens back to Cross-Canadian Ragweed and how you guys sounded back in the past in your prime and pays homage to a lot of things. And you also got to work on it with Mike McClure. You've worked on a lot of projects before with him in the past, sang with him before, as well as his daughter. So obviously this album means about as much as anyone could.
Yeah, you know, I'd mentioned earlier about getting away from who I was, but I was doing it on purpose because I was like kind of testing myself. You know, I was with a guy was in my band that he was a singer and guitar player, and we were kind of splitting the fronting duties, you know, and he's from a blues background, and I'm not. You know, I'm from country and from old country and you know, spitting and cussing rock and roll. That's where I come from. And, you know, we collaborated for one album, and I dug it. I really did, but it wasn't my thing. And so once we got away from there, I started slowly working my way back towards how I write. And I've had some people, you know, say, well, this record sounds like old Ragweed. It's like, well, it's because I wrote it. I mean, you know, when it comes down to it, Jeremy and I, on, you know, Jeremy on bass and harmonies, I mean, that's the first things that you hear on an album are the riffs and the voices. And that's what Jeremy and I were to that band. I mean, the other guys were drums and rhythm guitar, you know, and we really led that band. And to get back into the studio and say, hey, Jeremy, this is us. You know, this is how we do it, and this is how we need to sound. And let's don't try to make this song any different than it is. You know, so really, we just wrote the songs, walked in there, and recorded them. I mean, that's how we've always done it. It's just my style of writing, you know. And I didn't have to try anymore. That sounds cocky, but I didn't have to try. Like the last couple of Departed records, I was trying too hard. And I thought that, like, it was a good effort. But I thought I liked half of those records, not the entire records. But with this one, you know, we took our time. I waited till the piano player left because I didn't want to have to hire another piano player to do these parts on the road. So we just did it as basic as we could, and it's just tell the story. Really, just get in there and play the song and tell the story, and don't do anything special. And it worked, and it got people to listening again, and people saying, you know, this is the sound that we were missing, you know. So I'm not going to change it again. You know, I was looking for something different just because of embarrassingly enough, it was just, I was bitter because my band broke up. So I was trying to change what I was, but this is my favorite. This is my favorite since like the second to the last Ragweed record, which was my favorite one. So I'm really enjoying it again. Everybody's happy and everybody's healthy and can sing again. You know, I went through some voice things where I almost lost it. Now I got it back. I'm singing like I'm 25 years old again. So it's a good, I feel revived, you know?
Yeah, well, that's definitely a big, big key to, you know, being able to play as long as you have, as long as you still feel like you're in your 20s. I mean, really, you could play till you're 70 if you wanted, like, well, just about every act out there. And yeah, Hopefully you do.
That's my plan.
Well, that, hey, you know, Courtland, let's see, this is not really sure what year of Courtland they're on, but hey, maybe you can come back in 30 years or so and see if you still got it. But to hear back now from that new album, this will be Lipstick off of Cody Canada and the Departed's latest one, 3.
Laughing in the dress that he bought for her. He's just along for the ride. She'll pay a telling lies for the lipstick dries, dying on the inside. Beauty can be as deep as sin, luster cannonball. It has been since the dawn of man. It will be till the mountains fall. And here we go, over and over again. And how many times must we try to pretend that it's ever gonna change now? It ain't never gonna change now. It ain't never gonna change. Driver stops just up the block just to watch her walk. Under the sheets, the queen of the streets wipes that lipstick off. And here we go, over and over again. And how many times must we try to pretend that it's ever gonna change now? It ain't never gonna change now. It ain't never gonna change.
Lipstick from their newest one, their newest album, 3. Obviously, with that being released, you guys haven't had a whole lot else to do. Been touring down in Texas, coming up here to, I guess, Kansas, Nebraska for the weekend. And then before you get on back down to Texas, other than touring and promoting 3, anything else you guys have been doing? Anything else you have planned for the upcoming future?
My wife and I just opened up a music school, School of Rock, in New Braunfels, Texas. That's where we live. So really, you know, I mean, back when we first started doing this years ago, you know, we were sitting around the house in Stillwater playing music all during the week, and the weekends come up and we were in the band. So really, it's back to doing that again, but now we're teaching another generation to do what we did, you know, and try to steer them in the right direction. So really, that's it. I get home and it's music. I leave home and it's music. It's just, and there's nothing wrong with that.
No, but definitely not.
We're promoting this record, and we're not doing any videos or anything. I feel like that's kind of a waste. Not a lot of people see them anymore, you know? So we're just really relying on doing the live thing.
How much old cross-Canadian ragweed music are you guys going to be playing compared to this album as well as the rest of your repertoire in The Departed?
You know, we do a lot. We do a lot. And it's been recently since I got my voice back all the way. It's been like the 2.5, 3 hour shows again. So we try to squeeze as much in as we can. And now obviously there's more material when it comes to the ragweed stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So I play a lot of it. I mean, we play everything from the early days of ragweed till the last record. And with The Departed, you know, the first two records I barely touch. The Oklahoma record we did was a lot of fun, but it was a record that I never really intended on playing those songs forever. I just wanted to, honestly, I wanted to put money in my friends' pockets that wrote those tunes. I wanted to pay homage to the people that put me here.
Yeah.
And give them some money, you know, because I knew that a record label would do that. And the next one was Adventus. I probably played two songs off that record. I mean, it wasn't one of my favorites. And Hippie Love Punk. we do three or four, and the new one we do a lot. So we really try to cover as much as we can just to make everybody happy.
Yeah, it's definitely always important. So if you were to have to pick one song that you're going to be playing in Courtland, which would that be?
You know, one of my favorite songs ever to play is Dimebag off our garage record from 2005. That's one of my favorites. That's actually what we're teaching at the School of Rock today, is that song. So that one will definitely happen. It might even happen first rattle out of the box.
Well, then I guess for all of you who attempted last year to go from the Cloud County Fair and Logan Mize to back to Courtland then, I guess you're going to have to make sure you're right there at Courtland for the start time. So with that, here is Dimebag.
Back there, God bless that man, ripped from us by the devil's hand. Only thing in his plan was love and rock and roll. Cowboy from hell on a twisted trail, swept away where the wild winds will. Sad truth is you can never tell when it's your time to go. Oh, bad news travels faster than any good news that you hear. Just one more dark disaster makes you wonder why we're here. Where were you in 94 when they found him down there on the floor? Guess he couldn't take no more, a needle and a gun. Where did you sleep last night with the angels locked up tight? Love was his only lie, did you have another one? Well, bad news travels faster than any good news that you hear. Just one more dark disaster makes you wonder why we're here.
Singer sit down on KR92. Here with me again is Cody Canada of the Departed, former frontman for Cross Canadian Ragweed. Now, as we mentioned earlier, you know, and as you've been talking pretty much the entire interview, obviously you guys stopped playing Cross Canadian for a while, you know, just personal feelings, didn't quite know if that was what you wanted to do. Obviously it wasn't your band anymore, but it was still your music and it was still what people wanted to hear, as you said that lady informed you. If you want to just go ahead and talk about that a little bit more, I guess, because, you know, it's your music and people love to hear it.
Yeah, you know, we were doing 280 shows a year with Ragweed, and we were on the road 280 days, let's put it that way. We were probably doing 220 shows, but the rest was on the road time. So, you know, it was pretty grueling. I mean, I know this is music and everything, and it doesn't seem that hard. But you know, when you have little kids at home and wives at home, you know, it's hard to keep things together. You know, it's hard to not miss your kids walking, or it's hard to you know, keep a marriage healthy, you know, and stuff like that. So, man, we had a lot going on. And then also trying to stay ahead of the game and stay number one in our bracket, you know, that's a lot of work. You know, they always wanted a record every year from us, and I just don't write that way. So when the band split, you know, I was ready to take a break. And that's really what I should have done. I should have just taken 6-7 months off and just regrouped with three people in the band and and just dove in and started again. But I don't know. I needed to walk away from all that for a bit, because I feel like I've been singing the same songs for 16 years, and which I had been. And I don't know. Unfortunately, I got bitter. And that lady, Lori is her name, out in San Francisco, I was playing an acoustic show with Jason Boland, and I wrote a song called Jenny about this girl in San Francisco, and somebody asked for it. I said, yeah, I think I can remember that. And then Lori was standing in the middle, and she said, it's not the band we miss, it's the songs. Please sing it. Her exact words were, sing your damn song. And I said, you got it. And then from the rest of that night, I didn't play anything new. For the rest of that night, I played nothing but the old stuff, and it was such a killer night, and everybody loved it. And I don't know, it just made me feel relevant, you know. And there's a lot of musicians out there, you know, and it just made me feel like I've done something right. And I came back, and this is a different group of guys in my band. I came back from California and told them, I said, hey, look, I'm adding all the old stuff. I'm putting everything back in to rotation. And those two guys said, we don't like that. It's like, well, man, I really don't care, because our crowds are depleting, and it's because I'm being hard-headed. And if we start playing these old songs again, we're gonna get our crowd back. And those two guys didn't like that, so they quit. And once they quit, I got the guys in the band that I actually needed to be in the band. And man, it really was just like, I feel like I restarted so many times with the departed. But that last time, that was it. I knew it. I knew that having a three-piece band, playing the old songs, and then writing new ones like I used to write the old ones, I just knew that this was the way it was going to be, and it was going to be comfortable, and everybody's going to be happy. And our crowd started getting bigger, you know, and the next thing I know, we got 1,200 people in Dallas, Texas again, you know. So it's been a good journey. I haven't made the best decisions, but I haven't made terrible ones, you know.
No, I definitely have to agree with you on that one, and especially with you being as popular as you've remained, you definitely got something going right. So to, I guess, harken back to that old music and go ahead and play one more Cross Canadian Ragweed song, hopefully we can hear it on the 28th in Courtland, here is Cry Lonely.
Cry lonely, but you don't really want me.
back here one more time with me on Cernad Singer Sit Down is Cody Canada for The Departed. And Cody, before we sign off here, I guess just go ahead and veer off topic a little bit. Now, obviously, you're a Oklahoma State guy.
Mm-hmm.
And any plans, I guess, as I know a lot of the young listeners in the area joked about it, or at least the crowd I run with, of maybe making it down to Calf Rye, as we're told it's quite a good time. Any plans on going up there next year?
You know, I don't know. We get offers from those guys, and sometimes we do it, and sometimes we don't. But my heavy obligation is homecoming. I play homecoming at Eskimo Joe's every October. And I don't know if that runs into playing Calf Rye. I don't think so. I think that's at least 90 days out. But I don't know. If they call me, I'll say yeah. But if not, I'll see everybody at homecoming. That's a fun gig for me. I got my head split open at Calf Rye one year. Actually, the last year of ragweed, somebody threw a bottle at Calf Rye and split my head and had like 28 staples.
Jeez. Wow.
There might be a little bit of a hesitation to play in there.
Yeah,
it's hard to concentrate when you got stuff flying in your face.
Yeah, that sounds pretty wild. Other than obviously homecoming, you know, that's a huge deal. Where would you have to say your favorite place to play is, that obviously a repeat performance, or I guess just even one time that you might not ever go back to?
There's places all over the map. I mean, I've been from, you know, I've played 2 weeks in Germany, and I did a rendezvous, and it was called a country rendezvous in Le Puy, France. And it was like Bolin and Reckless Kelly and Marty Stewart. And had a lot of people on the side of that French mountain.
People showed up for you guys in France?
Oh, yeah.
Wow.
It's pretty amazing. I mean, when we went to Germany, I mean, we just went to Germany by ourselves. We weren't playing with Marty Stewart or anybody. You know, it was, we played 2 weeks in Germany, and every night we had a couple hundred people at least, you know, there to see us. And it was pretty amazing to us that people knew who we were.
Yeah, I would.
But I got to say that my all-time favorite place, and I am biased because it's Oklahoma, but it's Kane's Ballroom in Tulsa.
Okay, yeah, I've heard of the place before. Right now, next biggest trip would have to be down to Billy Bob's, but maybe I'll mark that on the list.
Billy Bob's still happens for us. We do that every now and then. We play in and around Dallas-Fort Worth area a lot, but Tulsa at Kane's Ballroom, that's definitely hands down the place for me.
Jaden Boxley, if you're listening, I guess we got our next road trip planned out. Well, Cody, I guess anything, I don't know, anything special that crowds should be looking forward to hearing from you guys? I've only had one opportunity to hear you guys before. That was back in old Hayes America. However, unfortunately, there was a little bit of confusion among Hayes's finest, and I ended up having to spend all of your concert in handcuffs outside of my house. And
that happened.
Yeah, they weren't going to give me a refund on my ticket. And at that point, by the time they figured out they had the wrong guy, it was a little bit too late to get into the concert. So, yeah. Anything that they should be looking forward to, especially?
Man, I don't think so. I mean, like I said, you know, we've been doing everything. I mean, if somebody wants to hear something, we've been doing it. You know, it's fun. It's fun to see people smile because of something that you created. So, I mean, I guess just look forward to having a good time because we're bringing it.
Well, Courtland Fun Days is always that for sure. Again, that's going to be Saturday, July 28th. After a fun-filled weekend, you can either spend it at the Cloud County Fair or for Courtland Fun Days. Remember, though, to end your night, definitely going to want to be there downtown for Cody Canada and The Departed. So to end things now, we're going to hear one more Departed tune, Easy. And so before we sign off, Cody, thanks for all of your time here sitting with us on the second edition of Cernad Singer Sit Down. Yes, I'll see you in Courtland.
All right, buddy. Thank you. Thank you guys for listening.
Yep. Thank you so much. And here is Easy.
It's religion.
moaning and the bitching, lying and the stealing and the cheating politicians coming right at me through the satellite feed. Make this day easy on me. Makes this day easy on you. Straight and honest, the good Lord above. Bloody knuckles and a warm heart of love. Say you'll do it when you say you'll do it. It ain't ever gonna